Welcome to the Patient Assessment and Management Trauma Skill. In this skill, you will have 10 minutes to perform your assessment and voice treat all conditions and injuries discovered. You should conduct your assessment as you would in the field, including communicating with your simulated patient. You may remove the simulated patient's clothing down to his or her shorts or swimsuit if you feel it is necessary. As you progress through this skill, you should state everything you are assessing, specific clinical information not obtainable by visual or physical inspection, for example, blood pressure, will be given to you only when you ask following demonstration of how you would normally obtain that information in the field. You may assume you have two partners working with you who are trained to your level of care. They will correctly perform the verbal treatments you indicate necessary. I will acknowledge your treatments and may ask you for additional information if clarification is needed. Do you have any questions?
After I received my scenario from the evaluator, I'll approach the scene, making sure that the scene is safe. I have my PPEs on. I'll ask, how many patients do I have? Do I only have the one patient? I'll assess whether or not I need additional resources to help me with this patient, possibility of power company, police, fire, something like that. I'll get a general impression of my patient. It appears to be a 35-year-old male patient or maybe a female patient not responding to my approach. I'll also restate my mechanism of injury, and that would be based on the information that I received from my scenario, such as, so this patient was struck by a vehicle or whatever the scenario may be. As I approach and I see that my patient is not responsive to me and this is a traumatic situation, I'll have my partner, imaginary partner, go ahead and take C-spine control, put in the head in neutral alignment. I'll then assess the level of consciousness of my patient. Hey, are you okay? You okay? There's no response to voice. Hey, can you hear me? I'll inflict a little bit of pain, pinching the trapezius muscles. Still no response to pain now, so I deem my patient as unresponsive. Since my patient's unresponsive lying on the back, I'll have my partner immediately open up the airway with a modified jaw thrust. The only way I can be assured that my airway is open is I have to look, listen, and feel for breathing. I would ask my evaluator, do I see chest rise? The evaluator would respond either yes or no. If there's no chest rise, then we would immediately begin bag valve mask ventilations. If I do have chest rise, of course, I would want to know, is my chest rise equal, bilateral, and of an adequate depth? Those answers would all be yes or no. If the chest rise was not equal bilaterally, I would immediately expose the chest to determine what may be causing the chest not to expand appropriately. If the depth of respiration is not adequate, then of course we would begin immediate bag valve mask ventilations. After I have gotten the information from my evaluator to reaffirm what I'm doing, I would say, so my quality of respirations is adequate, yes or no? And then the evaluator could tell me that. Of course, if it's not, then we would apply a bag valve mask. If it is, we're immediately going to take and apply a non-rebreather. In this station, you're voice treating all of your treatments that you'll be doing for the patient. So we can verbalize that we're putting on the non-rebreather mask at 15 liters per minute. As soon as I have that done, I would look to see if I have any hemorrhage. I'm looking for puddles, not just little wet spots of blood on the clothing, because that would not be significant. So I look for any bleeding and then check for a carotid pulse as my patient is unresponsive. Do I have a pulse? The answer would be yes or no. If the answer is yes, then I would immediately ask what is the rate, the rhythm, and the quality of my pulse. Not that I can do a lot about it, but it gives me a lot of information about the hemodynamic status of my patient. Of course, a shocky patient is going to be a weak, rapid pulse. A patient with a head injury would probably be a bounding pulse that is slow, if you recall the Cushing's triad. Once I have taken care of airway, breathing, and circulation, I would then have enough information to know that this is a load-and-go situation. If I'm having trouble with the airway, I can always go in and put an oropharyngeal airway to help with the modified jaw thrust that's being performed to keep the airway open. So I would measure and insert the oropharyngeal airway. I have my partners, since this is a load and go situation, have somebody go and start getting me the bag valve, long spine board, head blocks, and everything that I need to properly immobilize my patient. While that's being done, I'm going to start my rapid trauma assessment or my secondary exam on the patient, starting at the head. I'll palpate the back of the head, looking for any blood on my hands, checking for any depressions, any loose segments. I'll immediately look at the eyes to see if they are equal and pearl. I can check the ears to see if I have any fluids coming from the ears. As I come on down, visualizing the nose to make sure there's no clots or anything there. Move the non-rebreather, look into the mouth to see if there's any obstructions, which I did not hear when I initially did my assessment. So if I have not already put in the OPA, I could do it at that time. Palpate the back of the neck, see if there's any irregularities there. Looking at the front of the neck for trachea deviation and neck vein distension. While I'm at the neck, I want to go ahead and measure and apply the appropriately sized C-collar. Again, we can voice treat our patient, and you should be able to voice this with no problem in this station. C-collar is now in place. We're going to expose the chest. You cannot correctly assess the chest without visualizing it first. I don't see any type of injuries or anything. If I did, of course, I would address those at this time. I'll palpate behind the shoulders, again, looking for decap BTLS, checking for blood on my hands. Come down the clavicles, palpate down the sternum, and actually squeeze the rib cage to see if we have stability. I'll listen for lung sounds. We'll have a stethoscope in the room. You can choose to use it or just verbalize that I'm listening on the left side of the patient, and then I'll listen to the lung sounds on the right side of the patient. I'm wanting to make sure that the breath sounds are clear and equal bilaterally and that I have adequate volume there. I can also listen over the heart for heart tones to see if I have clear, crisp heart tones. Once I've done that, before I cover her back up, I can check the abdomen, looking for any bruising or anything. Palpate all four quadrants of the abdomen, down and in. If I did see any bruising or any damage to one of the quadrants, of course, that would have been the last quadrant that I would have palpated. Cover the patient to keep them warm. Examine the genitalia area for bleeding. If this was a male patient, I'd sweep for a prioprosal. Male or female, I'm a down and in checking for pelvic stability. If we do not have pelvic stability, of course, we'll stop immediately our palpation. Expose the legs. Palpating the legs, checking for stability there. Also, the skin content for the legs, noticing any damage, checking pedal pulse, motor sensation. Same thing on the left leg, palpate down, visualizing, palpate, motor sensation. Come back up to the arms, checking skin color and temp, palpating down, and check my radial pulse. Palpate down, skin color and temp, checking the radial pulse. This time I've completely assessed the anterior portion of the body. We need to be able to roll the patient to us and be able to put them on the spine board next. So on our head man's count, C-collar in place, oxygen in place, the front of the body being assessed already, hand on the shoulder and on the hips. We'll have another individual at the feet. Of course, the head man's going to count. Head man's count, 1, 2, 3. We'll roll the patient up. Keeping the hand that's on the shoulder in place, that stabilizes the patient. Taking the hand furthest away from the head, palpating down the back, the buttocks, and down both legs, checking for injuries. No injuries found. Verbalize that we bring the spine board to us. On the head man's count, we're going to bring the patient back to the spine board. Head man's count, 1, 2, 3. Ease the patient down. Make sure that the patient is centered on the spine board. No lateral movement is allowed. We would go from foot back up to the head to get the patient centered. Once the patient is centered, we'd strap across the chest, across the pelvis, depending on the number of straps, above and below the knees. Now that the torso is secured, we would put head blocks on to stabilize the head, one on both sides, strap that down to the board. Head man is now done. We can take the stretcher. We would take the spine board before we moved it, reassess the patient's pulses both distally and any motor sensation. Now we can move the patient to the ambulance. Once we get our patient in the back of the ambulance, as an EMT, you'd want to get the vital signs, which could include pulse oximetry, as well as blood glucose level, and we'd immediately begin transport, call for ALS backup, because this is an unresponsive patient, and probably more than our scope of practice would allow us to do is what this patient's going to need. As we are en route, either to the hospital or for ACLS intercept, we will completely remonitor the patient, continuously reassess this patient from level of conscious airway, breathing, and circulation, making sure that our interventions have been successful. At that time, I would be through with my patient.